all actors' careers, there's always going to be those periods of time where there's just, you know, not that much you're interested in doing. And so I'm just not, I guess I'm a bit type A, as they call it. I'm not one to sit around waiting for the phone to ring. I like having other things that I get involved with, and just, you know, I love, you know, the balance between doing something like working in the theater or working in films, and then when there's nothing I'm particularly interested in doing, having something creative that I'm doing myself, where I'm the captain of that particular ship and I'm not waiting for somebody else to.
Listen, we're so pleased to have you on the show. Congratulations on the film. It's done rather well at the box office, hasn't it? I'm sure the DVD will do equally well.
I think it comes out next week.
Next week,
December 10th. And the special things on it are really quite wonderful.
Thank you so much, Karen Allen.
My pleasure.
Lunch, we're lined up alongside me, Jackie Brambles, are Colleen Nolan, Carol McGiffin, and Linda Bellingham. Still to come in just a little while, we'll be welcoming the wonderful Matthew Kelly. But first of all, there is a story in a lot of today's papers about a group of old age pensioners who have found themselves in a spot of bother. Well, why? They've been talking too loudly every day. They like to have a little get together on the benches out. But it seems other residents have complained they're causing too much of a din.
Aww.
Leave them alone. Yeah. Has anyone... surely no one's ever accused you of being noisy.
Me?
Yes. In all honesty, can you imagine her sitting on a bench outside your flat? Because you are loud.
I know, but I can't help it. You know, I'm really aware of it now because I'm spending quite a lot of time with someone who is quite softly spoken. I'm quite...
And you're not doing a lot of talking at the moment.
Has he commented on your
on
the volume? Has he commented?
No, he hasn't. He wouldn't. I know. He wouldn't. But I am aware of it because, you know, because I've got a balcony in my flat, and where I live is there's like a courtyard, and it's like a surround sound thing, and it just echoes everything. You can hear everything.
I love that.
It's a nightmare. And you can't have your windows open. But when I'm out there, I know I'm on the phone, and I can't help being quite loud. So I know everyone can hear what I'm saying, but when he's on the phone up there, I can't hear him, and I'm in the same room.
Yeah.
And I'm like, trying to go, is he talking? What's he saying? I'm like, trying to listen.
So
I'm being nosy,
part of noisy. Well, it's like when we went out, me and my sister Maureen went out for lunch one day with Carol, and we had a great day, but when we left, Maureen went, God, she's so loud. Because everyone in the restaurant kept going.
I do. I have conversations which are usually
and you've got that
private
laugh.
Conversations.
Got a very
in restaurants
loud laugh.
And everyone
really
can hear.
Loud
I know.
Laugh.
And I've got a.
I'd hate to see a party where you and my husband were present, because my husband has got. Oh, he's got two volumes. One is this. And the other one's that. Where he's got this booming, loud voice, especially when he's on the phone. He is incapable of just talking like a normal human being.
Well, no, it's me too.
And the other night, somebody, how dare they, phoned our house at like 10 o'clock at night, one of our family members, which is like, my God, who's calling at this time of night? You'll wake the kids. Quick, get the phone. And I would have gone, yes, hello, Mum. Okay, yeah, I'll call you tomorrow. David, hey, how's it going? I'm
like... Mr. Spain's like that. He's on that phone, and people say he's on the phone a lot, isn't he? And I go, yes, isn't it sweet? And then you hear, yes, I know, my lover, to be fair. And he's got steel heels on his shoes. So he's bang, 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 up and down, up and down. And we're in a flat, the people below must go mad. You know, no. And he says, shush, shush.
I think one of the worst things is, you know, if you stay in a hotel and, you know, you've had a late night or whatever, and then you've got your do not disturb sign on, and I think, well, apart from guests late at night, like her, in the corridors, or coming back shouting. But the worst ones for me are the housekeepers in the morning.
Yeah, they're bad too.
It's got 6 o'clock in the morning going, all right, Margaret, you bring the bin bag.
Oh, can I just quickly tell you?
No, but what about...
Oh, please, let me just quickly tell you. I was in Russia doing a film, and they were bloody, blimmin' noisy. And I opened... opened the door one morning to shut up. This is a true story. And there was a huge man one end of the corridor and a huge man with guns drawn. And I went, will you? Ah, oh, good morning. Good morning.
You know when you have a hotel and there's a and you can hear everything. Everything.
All right, natter, natter, natter. Thank you.
Shut up.
Time for a second try at today's competition, where you've the chance to win a whopping 10 grand to spend at Marks and Spencer's.
Yes.
Very nice little start to the Christmas shopping. Now, to be in with a shot at winning the lot, you need to answer this question correctly. In fashion, drain pipes, flares, and boot cuts are all types of what? Is it A, jeans, B, jackets, or C, jumpers? Call 09012 931 941. Calls cost £1 from BT Landlines. Calls from other networks may be higher, and from mobiles will be considerably more. Text A, B, or C to 63303. Text cost £1 plus one standard network rate message. Digital satellite viewers can enter by pressing their red button now, and you can also enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. All lines close at 10 a.m. on Saturday, the 8th of November. Entries made after this time won't be counted, but may still be charged. And the very best of luck. Now, in just a little while, we'll be chatting to Matthew Kelly about the recent journey of discovery he made whilst taking part in a programme about his family's experiences of the First World War. Next Tuesday, of course, we'll see the 90th anniversary of the end of the Great War. And whilst many of our generation do know all about the sacrifices our relatives made for us and their country, not everyone does. So what do we know about our own family's experiences? What stories have we, learned?
Can I reiterate that and say, you know, that generation will soon be not with us anymore. And I think for children, they talk about wanting children to enjoy history. The best way is to tell them a real story. Mm. And my dad was an RAF pilot, and he'd had a DFC, AFC, and bar. And he didn't talk about it much, because they don't. They're very, you know, self-effacing about it. But he was a bomber pilot, and he used to tell a story about a fighter pilot, German fighter pilot, tried to shoot him down during the war, and it went on for about 5 minutes, a long time, you know, being shot at, and failed to bring him down. So the German pilot actually flew alongside, tip wings, gave him the thumbs up sign, and flew away.
Is that an amazing story?
I love talking to my grandma about, you know, the war. Obviously, it wasn't a great time, but, you know, she used to love talking about it. And her brother won the Victoria Cross because, and she had this little thing on her sideboard, which I've got now, which was just an announcement in the paper about, you know, what he'd done. And when you read what he did, it was just like, oh, that is true bravery. He'd, like, gone out into no man's land under heavy fire and saved 9 men who had been badly injured, carried them back on his own, or dressed them
and
as
kept
well
going back.
Over 5 days. Yeah, kept going out under shell fire and heavy fire and saved these 9 blokes and got the VC for it. And I remember she always used to show it to me and tell me, and when I was little I didn't really understand what she was going on about, but I was still fascinated by it. And the other story was my mum always used to tell me about when she was evacuated during the Second World War. And I think she'd gone up to Newcastle or something, and she was separated from her brother. And she always told me this story. She said, well, then we had to relocate our parents because nobody really knew where anybody was. And she said, the authorities came and said, so what does your mum and dad look like? My mum said, well, my mum looks like Gracie Fields and my dad looks like the bloke on the player's fag packet. And they found them. And yeah, and it's a story that will never ever leave me. I'm used to hear it all the time.
You're
from
absolutely right. It just brings it to life, doesn't it?
It does, yeah.
I had this sort of story of my two granddads, and one of my granddads, my mum's dad, worked in a gun factory, and so obviously it was a very specialised job. They evacuated everyone who worked in the factory and relocated the factory to Poole out of London. And so he was down there, and he was sort of did that during the day, and then he was in Dad's army. He was in the Home Guard. And my mum's got the certificate on her wall and stuff. And my other granddad, my father's father, was a fireman during the Blitz, and he was sort of sent to every city that was bombed, and hearing all these amazing stories. Mm. And as you said, it's not told with any arrogance. It's not told with any bravado. It's all you almost have to pull it.
Yeah.
Well, I'd never met anyone or knew of anyone that had relatives that had been in the war till I met Ray, whose dad and granddad had both been in the war, and his mom was in the WAF. Was it? Yeah. I think that's how him and his mom met. Ray's dad, Sergeant Sid, as he always calls him. And he sat down one day, his dad left him all his medals and his granddad's medals, and he sat down with Jake one day when Jake was about 8, and told him all the stories that his dad had passed down to him. And I was in the kitchen, actually, and it was actually like listening to the best story ever. Mm. And Jake went off to school on this show and tell day and brought all these medals in and told his classmates and everything. He got this little certificate for having the best show and tell. And it's great, actually, to tell your kids that, because it is interesting, you know, because it is like a story that their imagination runs wild with.
And I think you hear it, watching the James Bond film, and you know all the violence in PlayStation, I was thinking, God, we're so immune now. Our children are so immune to violence. Stories like that about your granddad, great uncle, you know, that the reason they are self-effacing and you have to get